I'm Wallalas, neurosurgeon from Thailand. Today, I'm your moderator. Today, we have our special guest, Dr. Victor Hugo Perez. He's a neuroanatomist, neurosurgeon from Mexico City. Today, he will give us a special topic about cerebral veins and sinus sharing approach. And at the end, we will have the poll test quiz as well. So, welcome.
Thank you. Thank you. It's very nice to be here. Today, I'm going to talk about the cerebral veins. So I just want to know if the screen is complete, all the screen?
Yes, you need to make it bigger, Victor.
A bigger?
Yeah.
A bigger one? Okay, let me try it again.
You fell off there.
Yeah. Okay. Now?
Yes, perfect.
Okay. Today we are going to talk about cerebral veins and the venous sinus. Cerebral veins, frequent variations in the size and connections of the cerebral veins have made it difficult to define a normal pattern. And the nomenclature used to describe the veins has infrequently been applicable to the operative situation. The fact that sacrifice of the major trunks of the deep venous system only infrequently leads to venous infection with mass effect and neurological deficit is attributed to the diffuse anastomosis between the veins. On the other hand, injury to this complicated venous network may cause severe deficits, including hemiplegia, coma, and death. The cerebral veins may pose a major obstacle to operative approach to deep-seated lesions. The cerebral veins may pose a major obstacle to operative approach to deep-seated lesions, especially in the pineal region under the temporal lobe and along the central part of the superior sagittal sinus. At numerous sites, the displacement of the veins may provide more accurate localizing information on neuroradiological studies than the arteries, because the veins are often more adherent to the brain than the arteries, which are not tightly adherent to the cortical surface. Here we have a meningioma in the let me see my presentation, because I think this is not the sequence that I want to show you, but
okay.
Let me try. This is a meningio in the lateral.
You fell off the screen share.
Okay, a big meningio in the anterior and middle skull base.
Okay, you're not screen sharing, Victor. It's off the screen.
Okay. Let me try again.
Okay,
let me try again. Is it okay now?
Yeah, make it bigger at the bottom.
Yeah. Okay. Let me
Whoop,
try.
You fell off again, Victor. You're off your game today.
Yeah. Now?
Yes. Perfect.
Okay. This is a big meningio. If we are going to make some approach like this, We need to understand not only anatomy of veins, arteries, and also the skull base and the brain. Here, this is the final resection of this tumor located at the lateral side of the cavernous sinus and also in the anterior fossa. And this is the postoperative result. The superficial veins drain the cortical surfaces. They collect into four groups of bridging veins, a superior sagittal group that drains into the superior sagittal sinus, a sphenoidal group that drains into the sphenoparietal or cavernous sinus, a tintorial group that converges on the sinuses in the tintorium, and a falcine group that empties into the inferior sagittal or straight sinus, or the tributaries. The later group includes the cortical veins that reach the straight sinus by emptying into the internal cerebral, basal, and great veins. The superior sagittal, sphenoidal, or tentorial group may drain the majority of the hemisphere if its tributaries are large. The superior sagittal group is composed of the veins that drain into the superior sagittal sinus. It includes the veins from the superior part of the medial and lateral surfaces of the frontal, here we have the frontal, parietal, and occipital lobes, and from the anterior part of the orbital surface of the frontal lobe. There is usually a free segment of vein, 1 to 2 centimeters in length, in the subdural space between the veins, exit from its bed in the pia arachnoid and its entrance into the sinus. This vein may empty directly into the superior sagittal sinus or may join a meningeal sinus in the dural matter en route to the superior sagittal sinus. This is an injection of the lateral aspect of the brain. I am injecting the vein of Labé. This is a big tributary, a big anastomotic, an inferior anastomotic vein, the bigger one in most brains. This is a good anastomosis between sylvian vein, trollar vein, and some other veins in the lateral aspect of the brain. If we want to make a dissection of the brain, it's much better to inject it with this kind of silicone. The sphenoidal group is formed by the bridging veins that empty into the sinuses that course in the inner surface of the sphenoid bone. This group, formed by the terminal ends of the superficial sylvian and occasionally the deep sylvian veins, drains the part of the frontal, like in here, temporal and parietal lobes adjoining the sylvian fissure. These veins drain into the sphenoparietal or cavernous sinus and less commonly into the sphenobasal or sphenopetrosal sinus. The tentorial group of bridging veins drains into the sinuses coursing in the tentorium, called the tentorial sinuses, or into the transverse and superior petrosal sinuses. This is the transverse sinus. In the tentorial margins, this group is composed of the veins draining the lateral surface of the temporal lobe and the basal surface of the temporal and occipital lobes. As you can see in here, here we have a Labé, vein of Labé in the posterior part of the temporal lobe. This is not common. The most common is to find this vein of Labé in the medial temporal lobe. This is an anterior vein of Labé anterior in the temporal lobe. So here we have two veins of Labé. This one in the anterior third of the temporal lobe, and this one in the posterior third of the temporal lobe. This is not usual. This is uncommon. Rotom described in 20 hemispheres only two veins of Labé founded in this site. The most common is in the medial third of the temporal lobe. Tensorial group. This group includes the temporobasal and occipitobasal veins and the descending veins, including the vein of Labé, from the lateral surface of the temporal lobe. These veins converge on the preoccipital notch, like in this part, preoccipital notch. And although they may enter the transversinus, most of them, except the vein of Labé, usually course around the inferior margin of the hemisphere to reach the lateral tentorial sinus. The vein of Labé usually enters the transverse sinus. The bleeding veins from the basal surface frequently adhere to the dura mater covering the middle fossa or the tentorium surface before joining the venous sinuses. Here we have the superior sagittal sinus joining with the transverse sinus. And here we have this temporal vein. The falcine group is formed by the veins that empty into the inferior sagittal or striate sinus. This is inferior sagittal sinus, or either directly of through the internal cerebral, basal, and great veins. The cortical area drained by the falcine group corresponds roughly to the limbic lobe, a group of convolutions that form a continuous cortical strip that grows around the corpus callosum and upper brain stem. In this brain, I put the parietal and occipital lobe and some of the temporal lobe in order to see these deep veins. The largest cortical areas are the parahippocampal and cingulate gyri, but the area also includes the paraterminal, paraolfatory gyri, and the uncus. Here we have the uncus. The veins on the paraterminal and paraolfatory gyri drain posteriorly toward the anterior cerebral vein, which empties into the anterior end of the basal vein. The anterior parts of the cingulate gyrus and corpus callosum are drained by the anterior pericallosal veins, which may join the inferior sagittal sinus or the anterior cerebral vein. The posterior part of the cingulate gyrus is drained by the posterior pericallosal vein, which drains into the great or internal cerebral veins in the quadrigeminal system. Here we have the crural and quadrigeminal system. Here we have the vein of Galeno, Galenus vein, and this is the striate sinus. And both Rosenthal veins. The area adjoining the isthmus of the cingulate gyrus and the area surrounding the anterior part of the calcarine fissure is drained by anterior calcarine veins, which cross the quadrigeminal system to reach the great vein or its tributaries. The medial part of the parahippocampal gyrus and uncus are drained by the juncal, anterior hippocampal, and medial temporal veins, which pass medially to empty into the basal vein in the crural and ambient cisterns. Dural sinuses and veins. The dural sinuses into which the cortical veins empty are the superior and inferior sagittal, superior sinus here, the straight transverse, tentorial, cavernous, sphenoparietal, sphenobasal, and sphenopetrosal sinuses. These sinuses form the terminal part of the superficial cortical venous system. I think that you agree with me. The most complex area of sinus is the cavernous sinus. Because of the cranial nerves, internal carotid artery, intracavernous segment of the carotid, internal carotid artery. And here we have the lateral aspect of the cavernous sinus. I remove the superficial cranial nerves, tier 4 and 5, in order to remove the dural, the dura, and here we have the 6th cranial nerve. Process forward from behind to the sphenoidal fissure. Here we have the Dorello's canal. The superior sagittal sinus courses in the midline, beginning just behind the frontal sinuses, and grows larger as it continues posteriorly in the shallow groove on the inner table of the cranium. It may communicate through the foramen secum with the veins of the nasal cavity. It drains into the transverse sinus at the internal occipital protuberance through a plexiform confluent venous complex called the torcular erophily that connects the superior sagittal, transverse, striate, and occipital sinus. Although the superior sagittal sinus may drain equally to the right and left transverse sinus, or predominantly or wholly to either side, it is usually the right transverse sinus that receives the majority of its drainage. The superior sagittal sinus drains the anterior part of the inferior surface of the frontal lobe and the superior portions of the lateral and medial surfaces of the frontal, parietal, and occipital lobes. Here we have a superior sagittal sinus, and this sinus is divided some centimeters behind the junction with the transverse sinus. This is also a variation in the anatomy of this superior sagittal sinus. The superior sagittal sinus and venous lacuna. The superior sagittal sinus curses in the midline, beginning just behind the frontal sinuses and grows larger as it continues posteriorly in the shallow groove on the inner table of the cranium. It may communicate through the foramen secum with the veins of the nasal cavity. It drains into the transverse sinus at the internal occipital protuberance through a plexiform confluent venous complex called the torcular erophily that connects the superior sagittal, transverse, straight, and occipital sinuses. Here we have a venous lacunae in the superior sagittal sinus. So here we have a dissection in I'm trying to dissect these bridge veins in the lateral aspect of the brain. This is very important to know how is this, this is an arachnoid, subarachnoid granulations. So when you are going to operate a meningio coming from the middle third of the superior sagittal sinus, it's very important to respect the veins. Do not coagulate them because we could have an hemorrhagic infarction because of these bridge veins.
Sí.
So remember that veins are very adherent to arachnoid. So it's very important to make a careful dissection in these veins. This is some arachnoid. So also in the medial third of the superior sagittal sinus is the site where we are going to find numerous bridging veins. So the tumor that arise in this region are a little difficult because of the adherence with some of these veins. Enlarged venous spaces called lacunae, like in this picture, are contained in the dura mater adjoining the superior sagittal sinus. The lacunae are largest and most constant in the parietal and posterior frontal regions. Smaller lacunae are found in the occipital and anterior frontal regions. In some cases, the separate lacunae are replaced by a simple lacuna on each side of the sinus. The lacuna receive predominantly the drainage of the meningeal veins, which accompany the meningeal arteries in the dura mater. Some investigators have recorded that the lacuna do not receive the drainage of the cortical veins. However, we did find sites of communication between the cortical veins and the lacunae. The cortical veins that empty into the superior sagittal sinus characteristically pass beneath rather than emptying directly into the lacuna to reach the sinus. Here we have another dissections in order to see this the superior sagittal sinus. Here we have some lacunae.
Vamos a seguir aquí despegando.
I am cutting some dura mater. Let me show you. This is a superior sagittal sinus. This one. I am cutting some dura mater. So in some cases, we need to make a careful dissection when we are going to remove meninges in this site. Okay, this is a big meningioma in the parieto-occipital region, in the third of the superior sagittal sinus, in the posterior third. This is the preoperatory view, and this is a post-operatory view. So I close the superior sagittal sinus in order to remove this big and complex meningeal. Here we have a coronal view, and this is an axial view of this patient. So I saw the patient 3 years after the surgery.
Para ver tu evolución, ¿cómo sigues? ¿Cómo vas ahora?
And I was asking the patient about his ocular function. He was in good condition after 3 years of surgery. So the superior sagittal sinus is triangular in cross section and has right and left lateral angles at its junction. with the dura mater covering the convexities and an inferior angle and its junction with the fogs. The cortical veins may pass directly to the superior sagittal sinus, or they may join the meningeal sinuses, which empty into the superior sagittal sinus. Well, I don't know what happened with this, but it doesn't matter. The inferior sagittal sinus courses in the inferior edge of the falls. It originates above the anterior portion of the corpus callosum and enlarges as it courses posteriorly to join the straight sinus. It arises from the union of veins from the adjacent part of the falls, corpus callosum and cingulate gyrus. The junction of the veins from the cingulate gyrus and corpus callosum with the sinus often forms an acute hook-like vein with the apex directed forward. The largest tributaries of the inferior sagittal sinus are the anterior pericallosal veins. The superior sagittal sinus may communicate through a venous channel in the falls with inferior sagittal sinus. This connection may infrequently be so large that the superior sagittal sinus drains predominantly into the inferior sagittal and straight sinus. Sorry for these lines, I didn't know what happened, but the straight sinus originates behind the splenium of the corpus callosum at the union of the inferior sagittal sinus and the great vein. It continues posteriorly and downward in the junction of the tentorium and falx. It may drain into either transverse sinus, but most commonly drains predominantly into the left transverse sinus. The transverse sinus, this is a view of dissection of the skull base. I injected the sinuses in situ, and here we have the junction of superior sagittal sinus and transverse, and both transverse sinus. Here we have the junction of the transverse sinus with the sigmoid sinus. And look at this. This is the superior petrosal sinus. This is the inferior petrosal sinus. Superior petrosal sinus connect the junction of sigmoid and transverse sinus with the posterior end of cavernous sinus. This is very, very important for the approach to the transpetrosal approach. The transverse sinus exits the tentorial attachments to become the sigmoid sinus at the site just behind the petrous ridge, where the transverse and superior petrosal sinus meet. Although the superior sagittal sinus may drain equally to the left and right transverse sinus, or predominantly or wholly to either side, it is the right transverse sinus that is usually larger and receives the majority of the drainage from the superior sagittal sinus. Here we have another picture. This is the inner skull base, and this is with dura mater and the sinuses. This is an artistic skull base. Here we have the meningeal, the superior petrosal sinus, inferior petrosal sinus, sigmoid sinus, and transverse sinus. This is the basilar sinus. Here we have the pituitary gland, optic nerves, internal carotid artery, supracranial segment, and the cranial nerves in the cavernous sinus. The superior petrosal sinus courses with the attachment of the tentorium to the petrous ridge. This is the petrous ridge. It's medial and connects with the posterior end of the cavernous sinus. The bridging veins that join it usually arise from the cerebellum and brain stem, not the cerebrum. The sinus may course over, under, or around the posterior root of the trigeminal nerve. The superficial sylvian veins may empty into an infrequent tributary of the superior petrosal sinus called the sphenoparietal. The largest veins on the lateral surface are the veins of Trollard and Labet, and the superficial Sylvian veins. The vein of Trollar is the largest anastomotic vein, joining the superior sagittal sinus with the veins along the Sylvian fissure. This vein is the largest vein connecting the veins along the Sylvian fissure with the transverse sinus. The superficial Sylvian veins courses along the surface of the Sylvian fissure and drains predominantly into the dura sinuses along the sphenoid ridge. Sorry for this music. This is the vein of Labé. This is the other aspect. This is another injection. The first one that you saw is another. This is in the other part of the brain, in the other hemisphere. So here we have the vein of Labé, the Sylvian vein, and the largest of these parietofrontal veins is named the Trollar vein, or the superior anastomotic vein. So in this case, we have a very good anastomosis between the vein of Labé, this one, and then some parieto-occipital vein, parietal veins. So this is going to the Sylvian fissure, and in the depth of Sylvian fissure, we have the vein of the Sylvian fissure. Here we have the Trollar vein. The vein of Labé, also called the inferior anastomotic vein, is the largest anastomotic channel that crosses the temporal lobe between the Sylvian fissure and the transverse sinus. It usually arises from the middle portion of the Sylvian fissure and is directed posteriorly and inferiorly toward the anterior part of the transverse sinus. It may cross the temporal lobe as far back as the posterior limit of the lobe or as far forward as the anterior third of the lateral surface. There may be double veins of Labé, in which case the posterior vein is usually larger. The text of this lecture was taken from Rotton's lectures. So in the experience of Dr. Rotton about venous injection of 20 hemispheres, he found this vein of Labé most common in the middle tier of the temporal lobe, like in this case. The cavernous sinus are located each side of the cella and pituitary gland. This is the cella and pituitary gland. Here we have the optic nerves, the ophthalmic artery coming from the supraclinal carotid artery, third nerve, and fourth nerve. Rotton described four triangles for cavernous sinus. The clinoidal triangle is the first one. The second is the oculomotor triangle. The third, the supratrochlear triangle. And the fourth is the infratrochlear triangle. This triangle is between the inferior trajectory of the fourth cranial nerve and the superior part of the ophthalmic division of trigeminal nerve. The cavernous sinus is defined as the dural space in which the cavernous segment of the internal carotid artery courses and contains not only the cavernous carotid artery, but also a venous confluence that receive veins draining the orbit, Sylvian fissure, and middle and anterior fossa, and has free communication with the basilar, superior, and inferior petrosal and intercavernous sinuses. Here we have a nice picture after dissection of dura mater and removal of the superficial cranial nerves. So here we have the intracavernous carotid artery and some arteries that are coming from this, from the posterior part of this intracavernous carotid segment. Here we have the tentorial artery, the meningeal dorsal artery, and here we have this is most sure that is the inferior ophthalmic artery. Here we have the inferolateral trunk and this sixth cranial nerve. The oculomotor, trochlear, and ophthalmic nerves course in the lateral wall. Here we have the lateral wall of cavernous sinus, third cranial nerve, fourth cranial nerve, the ophthalmic mandibular maxillar division of the trigeminal. The abducens nerve courses on the medial side of the ophthalmic nerve between it and the internal carotid artery. So this is Dorello's canal, and above these Dorello's canals, we have the Gruber's ligament. And this is the petrolingual ligament. So this is sixth cranial nerve. And this is of a cranial nerves, this is the only one that is inside the real cavernous sinus. The nerves in the sinus wall of sinus are from superior to inferior, the third cranial nerve, followed by trochlear nerve, ophthalmic, and abducens nerves. Here we have another beautiful aspect of the lateral aspect of this. Sorry for these lines. I do not know what happened, but they are. I don't know what happened.
Maybe okay. you can remove them through the pointers on the left side, on the left bottom side of the screen.
In the lateral?
There are some arrows on the left side, left bottom side of the screen. You can go there and remove the annotations, which is which was done accidentally.
Okay. Maybe I'm going to try after the lecture.
Yeah, it's no big deal.
Yeah.
Keep going.
There are four triangles in the cavernous sinus, four middle fossa lateral to the cavernous sinus, and two fossa in the paraclival area. We are going to review this, the triangles of cavernous sinus. Here we have the third cranial nerve, fourth, and the ophthalmic division of this trigeminal nerve. So as you can see here, we have some arteries coming from the intracavernous carotid artery. Here we have the meningohypophyseal trunk and the inferolateral trunk in this side. So these arteries are very, very important because they are going to give rise to small arteries for the lateral cranial nerves. The clinoidal triangle is situated between the optic and oculomotor nerves. This triangle is exposed by removing the anterior clinoid process. This is anterior clinoid process in the left side and in the right side. So here we have another picture with the third cranial nerve. I remove this clinoid process in order to see this triangle. So optic nerve, supraclinoid carotid artery, and ophthalmic artery. Oculomotor triangle. Two margins of this triangle are formed by the anterior and posterior petroclinoidal dural folds that extend to the petrous apex. The third side is formed by the interclinoidal dural fold that extends from the anterior and the posterior clinoid process. Here we have this triangle. The supratrochlear triangle is situated between the lower surface of the oculomotor nerve and the upper surface of the trochlear nerve. This is the upper surface of trochlear nerve, and this is the third cranial nerve. This is named as supratrochlear triangle. If you look at this, here we have the meningohypophyseal trunk. So which triangle are you going to open in order to find this meningohypophyseal trunk. Let's go in the next slide. Parkinson described a triangle within the lateral wall of the cavernous sinus through which the intracavernous portion of the carotid artery and its branches might be exposed for the surgical treatment of carotid cavernous fistula. This is known as Parkinson's triangle or infratrochlear triangle. So in a close view, here we have the meningohypophyseal trunk with four arteries. Some of them very common and one of them very uncommon. This meningohypophyseal trunk is giving rise to the inferior hypophyseal artery, to the tentorial or vernosconic artery, and the middle and the dorsal meningeal artery, and the McConnell or capsular artery. This is a lateral aspect of this cavernous sinus. If we displace the superficial cranial nerves, we can see, or the trigeminal, we can see the third, fourth, sixth cranial nerve, and this is the petrolingual ligament, and this is the intrapetrous segment of the internal carotid artery and the intracavernous segment. This is the ligament of Gruber, is in the above of the Dorelos canal. The basilar sinus is the largest venous connection between the paired cavernous sinuses. The superior and inferior petrosal sinuses also open into the lateral part of the basilar sinus, creating a large venous confluence along the posterior wall of the cavernous sinus. Here we have basilar sinus that is the largest venous connection between the paired cavernous sinus. Here we have the intercavernous sinus. Another view of this basilar sinus. So the abducens nerve enters a dural cave known as Dorelos canal. This is Dorelos canal, where it passes below the petrosphenoid ligament, known as Gruber's ligament, that extends from the lower part of the lateral edge of the dorsum cellae to the petrous apex to enter the cavernous sinus. Here we have an inferolateral trunk this artery. So another view, the inferolateral trunk, artery of the inferior cavernous sinus, this one, the inferolateral trunk, arises from the lateral side of the mid portion of the horizontal segment of the intracavernous carotid artery. Here we have the meningohypophyseal trunk. This is without a cellar and paracellar region, without injection. This is very, in order to understand anatomy of this region, is very important to make some injections of silicone or some latex. The meningohypophyseal trunk gives rise to these branches, tentorial artery called as or known as vernosconic acinari, which courses lateral to the tentorium, the inferior hypophyseal artery, the dorsal meningeal artery, and sometimes the capsular artery. In this view, we have a axial cut of the brain. Maybe in other lecture, we can talk about this because I think this is really beautiful to see this kind of cuts with a special staining known as Mulligan staining. So, for example, in this cut, in this axial cut, we can see the genu of corpus callosum, claustro, frontal operculum, the insula, choroidal plexus, posterior limb of internal capsule, anterior limb, putamen, head of caudate nucleus, and column of fornix. But let me show you what happened with the Mulligan state. With Mulligan state, we stain the only the gray substance. White substance do not stain, only gray substance. And let's go to see what happened. So, this is really beautiful because we can define all the gray substance. For example, only to recognize some structures in this view, we have the genu of corpus callosum, claustrum, this thin. A structure of gray substance, the claustrum. Frontal operculum, insula, splenium of corpus callosum, the choroidal plexus, posterior limb of internal capsule with number 7 in the 8th anterior limb, and the putamen is this head of caudate nucleus and column of fornix. Again, let me show you this. What's going to happen with the Mulligan staining? Maybe in other lecture we can approach this. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Victor, for a very great presentation. So it's a floor for everyone. So if you have any questions to ask Dr. Victor about his presentations, please feel free to ask. And after the questions, we will have 10 question quiz on the webcast in the Kahoot platforms. And Mr. Vijan will provide us the link to that. Oh, he is already. Okay. Does anyone have questions? No, I guess.
Okay, now's your time. Now's your time to shine, Morlix. Fill in the dead air.
Okay. The really beautiful, like basic things and cover that you have. Yeah, really nice presentations. I think let's move on to the quiz. Yes.
Okay, very good. Okay, let me get set it up here. Give me a second. It's with a platform called Kahoot, which we're going to start using regularly in these webcasts. Just let me log in and get ready.
Okay.
Okay. Now I'm going to display. Okay. Okay, I'm gonna screen share now. This is new, so be patient. We'll do the best we can, okay? And you need to go to kahoot.it in your smartphone, okay? And this is, okay, we're gonna stop playing here. And you'll be voting on your smartphone for the answers. Okay. Can you see it okay, Warlocks?
Yes, I can see it fine.
Okay, we're generating the pin now. Okay, here you can see the pin, right, Warlocks?
Yes, I can see the pin.
Okay, that's the number you punch in. You go to kahoot.it, okay, on your smartphone, and you punch in this pin here. So we're waiting for players, and we'll just wait a minute or two. And I'm going to also come in myself. And you're welcome to too, Warlick. Just punch in with your smartphone there. I'm going to Kahoot. You too, Victor. Are you there, Victor?
Yes, yes.
You gotta. Well, you're not gonna take it, obviously, but. Okay, I'm going to Kahoot.it, and then I'm punching the pin in, 708-4451. Okay, and enter, and you're gonna see me pop up coming in. I'm coming in as Daring Quail. I thought it was Daring Queen, but that's a little too racy. Okay, I'm in. Okay. Okay, Victor, Bold Rooster, very good. Okay, we may add a person or two, but we'll just start. And once again, with the question, just punch in on your smartphone the response. Okay, first question. Okay. And just punch in the response. And Victor will go over the, okay, Victor, I guess we have two even answers, basal sinus and cavernous sinus.
Yeah, cavernous sinus.
Okay, very good. Let's go to the next one. Champion Owl is pulled ahead. The foramen segment connects the superior sagittal sinus with A, nasal vein, pineal vein, temporal vein. Okay, Victor, nasal vein majority, is that correct?
Correct.
Great, okay, let's move on. Champion Owl is leading. The inferior sagittal sinus courses posteriorly to join. Superior sagittal sinus, straight sinus, cavernous sinus. Okay, the overwhelming majority with
straight sinus, correct.
Okay, very good. Code. So the people are listening. Let's see if Champion Owl maintains the lead. Geez, I can feel the tension. Superior petrosal sinus connects.
CS means cavernous sinus.
Okay. Hey, Victor, C? That's the correct answer, Victor?
Correct.
Very good. Champion Owl maintains the lead with Expert Lemon. Inferior and anastomic and anastomotic vein is called crying. Okay, overwhelming majority, vein of lobby. Is that correct, Victor?
Correct.
Very good. Champion Owl widens the lead. Victor, I hope you're not champion at all. Okay, Vano Trelat, is that correct, Victor?
Correct.
Excellent, excellent. Champion Owl maintains the lead. Which nerve is inside the cavernous sinus? Third, sixth, or fourth cranial nerve? Hey, Victor, six cranial nerve. Is that correct, Victor?
Six.
Very good. Very good. Majority rules. Champion Owl. And we have to do a lie detector test with Victor to make sure he's not the champion owl.
No, it's me.
Oh, it's a real person. Well, that's great. Okay, keep going. Abducens nerve enters the dural cave, known as. Okay. Is that correct, Victor?
Right.
Excellent, excellent. Two more. Champion Owl, my God, maintains the lead. Okay, infratrochlear triangle. I hope that question makes sense. Is that question? Does that question make sense, Victor? I may have made a mistake with that question. Sorry about that. I guess we have to take a pass on that.
All are going to be correct in this. Okay.
Okay. We'll give everyone credit for that.
Yeah.
Oh, good. It didn't affect the outcome. Champion Owl still. Okay. Comes down to the last question. It's going to be hard to beat Champion Owl. Okay, basal sinus. What, Victor A? Is that correct?
It's basilar sinus.
Okay,
no.
That's the one question we got wrong. Okay, let's total it up and get ready to make an acceptance speech if you win. We all know who the winner is going to be. Okay, you. Champion Owl. Okay, very good. Okay, Champion Owl, can you please introduce yourself? Who is it?
I think it's not fair.
Is that you, Doc? Is it you, Gorlex?
No, it's me. It's me.
Oh, it is. Very good. You took it handily.
No, I've started, but I make a mistake like the last question, so it's like.
Well, it's me, but it's not fair, you know.
I'm a
senior person. It's not fair.
No,
I agree.
Well, it's only right. It's only right, really. You've had the most experience, and there's talk that Warlick stuffed the ballot box.
Well, Professor Hugo, I really enjoy your anatomy. I'm really fond to visit you in your lab and learn more and more of your techniques and beautiful anatomy. I really appreciate that too much. And Warlox, you are always amazing us every day by your drawings and your beautiful brochures. I'm really, really honored to be part of this group. especially under Dr. Bennett, who is the, not the star, he is the universe now of the neurosurgery.
I used to be, but Warlocks is pushing me out.
No, no, no. Still, you are the galaxy. She is a star in your galaxy.
Doctor Abdallah, whenever you want, you are welcome to Mexico City, of course.
I'll be really very happy for that. I've got your email now, and when things are becoming better after Corona, hopefully I'll come and visit you and enjoy staying in Mexico. Thank you very much.
Yeah, Victor, you have a lab, right, in Mexico City at the university? Or
In the INCIFO, the Forensic Institute, the Forensic Sciences Institute here in Mexico City. Is a place where I am doing this cadaver research. So Carlos Villamayor want to make a question.
Of course. You see the question there, Victor? Oh, I'm sorry. Carlos, I'm sorry, Warlocks. I'm taking over your job.
Carlos Villamayor. Maybe turn on your microphone, Carlos Villamayor.
Carlos, ¿está allá? No parece.
Oh, yes, he's in the screen, Carlos Villamayor. As a computer.
Unmute. Carlos, ¿está allá? Parece que no, Victor.
Hello, John?
Oh, is it Carlos?
John, do you hear me?
Yes. Go ahead.
Oh, that was wonderful presentation. Victor, how are you?
Fine.
You hear me?
Yes. Can you please introduce yourself?
I'm Dr. Shams from Islamabad, Pakistan.
Welcome.
I am the most oldest fan of Dr. John Bennett. Since he launched that neurosurgical TV, actually I was resident at that time. Then I got my board certification and I get a lot of knowledge from this neurosurgical TV. I enjoy this neurosurgical TV since long. And maybe I don't come on the front, but I used to see. Victor, I know you first time introduced the silicon injection of silicon.
Okay, thank you. Thank you so much.
That was the first time when I saw this silicon injection live.
Yes. It's much better to study a brain.
This neurosurgical TV is doing really a wonderful job for all the neurosurgical community of this whole world.
Yes, I agree with Dr. Abdallah that John Bennett is a rock star.
man.
Person. Even,
well, save my job. Warlocks has taken it.
No, it's a very tough job. Very tough job, really. We can't.
No, this is fun. This is fun. You guys will like this platform. The more you get to know it, you know it. You've done it for a long time. And Victor knows it. And Warlocks is starting to see it. And Abdallah Zaidan, he's Joanna has seen it. So it's a fun platform. It's a fun way to learn. And you were doing it before Corona, when we were doing a lot of it.
It was launched in 2016, I think, at the December 2015.
Yeah, that's when we started doing them pretty regularly.
And there was a very competent personality, Ab Cherion.
Yes, Ab is still very active. He's moving to India. Okay, and great to see you. Let's see if we have some more questions here. Any more comments? I'm sorry, Warlocks, I'm taking your job. Go ahead. Just say, John, that's my job. Go ahead. Unmute, Warlock. You're still muted, Warlock.
Oh, I unmute myself already.
Okay. Okay, Warlock.
So it's time for questions. But as I check from the questions box, no one asked questions. But the vein, like cerebral vein, is a really important topic indeed for neurosurgeons like us.
It's your fault, Warlocks, if nobody asks a question.
Yeah.
Or a comment. Any comments? You don't have to. So what do you think of the Kahoot? Do you think it's worth it, Warlocks? Do you think it's worth it or no? You think it's just a waste of time?
Yeah, it's worth it.
You think it's worth it? You like it, Victor?
I mean, I like it, especially when I get lots of points.
Yeah. Yeah. What does the panel say about that? Does the panelist say anything about that? Is it worth doing? I'd like to do it. And I think Victor likes to do it. Well, we'll see. We'll see. Okay. I guess we can wrap it up, Orlick. So, okay. Go ahead. Go ahead. Wrap it up.
Thank you everyone for joining us today for Neuro Anatomy TV. I'm Walalas, and Dr. German is really welcome to you all. And wait for the next sessions. What is about, Dr. John?
Okay, this will all be posted on YouTube. So.
Okay, what is the next topic for next Monday?
Next Monday? Boy, Warlock, she caught me by surprise. So in other words, the pressure's on you, so you're putting it on me. Okay, yeah, put it on me at the last minute. Okay, Abby Shah is giving a lecture on lateral and let me screen share it. Oh, excuse me a second. Let me screen share this here. Okay, Abby Shah on November 9th is giving the lecture on lateral and third ventricles, surgical considerations and approaches. And that will be next week. So, okay, very good.
Yes.
Okay, Warlocks, wrap it up. Put a nice little bow in it, a bow tie.
I think not only that, I want to say something.
Oh, okay. Boy, this is a very smooth closing, huh?
Yes.
Okay. Any comments or anything? Did you say somebody had something to say?
Oh no, somebody just said that he cannot access to the Kahoot. Maybe next time you should have an instruction for how to use Kahoot before we start the webinar.
Yeah.
I mean, as the pin ID. And everybody's say excellent idea, excellent lecture, and the Kahoot is totally worth it. And next time we will do a lecture on lateral ventricle. Okay.
But boy, we'll work on the extraduction, the way you have a transition to get out smoothly. We didn't do it now, but we'll work on it. Okay, we'll see you next week.
Okay, thank you, everyone. Bye.
Thank you. Okay. Bye.